I'm T.
And I'm Jarvis.
Make sure you follow Fill in the Blanks on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter.
Check us out.
Opener for the Hawks, but on the same token, what did look good for the Hawks, much better than what looked good for the Falcons, was a couple of the rookies. So we know the rookie class was on display. Cam Reddish, for the first time, this was his professional debut. DeAndre Hunter, Bruno Fernando, they all made their State Farm Arena debuts last night against the Pelicans, or Monday night against the Pelicans. Hawks did lose 133-109, but which Hawks rookie won the night, or did Zion Williamson win the night?
I mean, from a local perspective, you know, that's where I'm always going to come from. So I think a guy like Cam Reddish, he won tonight for me because I can envision him being that guy to be able to come off the bench and make open threes. And as we all know, that Trae Young is the guy who's going to find that open guy. He's going to find him. And he did it last night, almost getting double digits in assists, of being able to create and find his people. Like, and Trae Young is so great at that. That's why I think Cam Reddish was an excellent draft pick. So I think he was the guy that kind of really just said, okay, I know this can be a guy that can come off the bench and knock down some shots when that second rotation comes in the NBA.
Yes, and you know, Jay Sanford asks, what's the record for the Hawks this year? Now, of course, we're just getting into the preseason. They're only one preseason game in, and they didn't get the W for that. Of course, on October 24th, they start the season at Detroit Pistons. We look for them to, at a minimum, increase where they were last year, which was 29 wins. Most pundits, including me, kind of agree that it should probably come into, like, the mid-30s. And I'd have to agree with you. I think Cam Reddish won the night, but I think DeAndre Hunter wasn't far off. They both ended up with double digits.
Show happened some to offensive beat. Game, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And what I liked about him is you could see them trying to buy into Coach Lloyd Pierce's philosophy. I had a chance to get out there to cover the game last night, and you're starting to see them pick it up with assists. You're starting to see blocks and steals from the gate from the rookie class. So good stuff we're going to see from the Hawks, hopefully upcoming this season. But what it didn't look good for was Baker Mayfield. So, on many fronts, right? I know
that
it
makes
does.
Me so happy.
You and a whole lot of people, right?
Because I was not sold on this guy when he was drafted by the Cleveland Browns with the number one overall pick. Because you have a guy who played well his rookie year. Okay, I get it. But a lot of people seem to fall in love with the personality versus the player. Mm-hmm. When you fall in love with the personality, the player kind of goes under the wayside. You kind of sweep it on the rug. Mm-hmm. And now he's getting exposed because he's ramping guys up. Richard Sherman thought he didn't shake his hand before the game. He actually did, but he got a little upset because he took off before everybody else took off. So I don't know what that – Richard Sherman, man, you my dog, man. I love you. Right. I love the way you play the game. But, hey, man, chill out just a little bit. You know, you don't need any extra motivation to pick off a second-year quarterback.
At all.
You're probably one of the best corners that ever played in the past decade in the NFL. So I think Baker is a guy – that you almost root for him to fail because he just has such an arrogance about him.
Yeah.
People don't want to admit that,
right?
But it's just something there that I just don't like, and it makes me happy that, you know, he had a horrible game last night.
Yeah, and good look for the former Falcons offensive coordinator Kyle Shanahan. He has the 49ers at 4-0, doing the darn thing out there in the NFC West. And certainly don't think that's a fluke because, hey, he's doing that behind the likes of Nick Bosa, who also is not Baker Mayfield's fan. He, of course, Mayfield had this whole plant a fake flag thing back when Oklahoma and Ohio State played in 2017. So Nick Bosa finally got his payback last night. He literally did a sack dance in the first half where he went to the sidelines, picked up a fake flag, and then just kind of waved that bad boy in Mayfield's face. And then the ultimate was just that, 33-3 beatdown. But
right.
Jarvis, as a former player, did you ever get snubbed during your playing days and then get the chance for payback?
Oh, yes. There was one particular time we were down in Tuskegee. We were playing against Tuskegee. And being on the road against that team is always it's a party when you go down there. I have to give them that. They are always amped up behind, down there and up on that little tool shed they call a stadium, home side of the stadium. So I think that there was this guy. he knew one of my friends from high school, and he had made a comment that that was a trigger for me when I was late as a teenager in the early 20s.
Right, right.
And he said something that, you know, that kind of got me a little ramped up. And the next play, I politely picked him up and put him in the running back's lap and made the tackle. And I put all 340 pounds on him so he can understand where I'm coming from. And then they took him out. They took the center out. I was playing nose guard, so they took him out for the rest of the game. And he didn't have a chance to retaliate from my retaliation. So I think I got my message. The message was pretty clear.
Yeah, I think payback on that. I think got payback, and you got payback quickly. So speaking of quick, let's get to rapid fire.
All right, so we are 5 games into the season, right?
5 games, and, 5 weeks in.
Redskins head coach Jay Gruden has been fired.
Yes.
It seems like he knew it was coming because he actually spent the night at the facility, showered right. and everything, and woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning and went to the owner's office.
Right, like,
So is it really that shocking? Right. Or he was just like, all right, he was just buying time till it was time to come.
I think so, because he did say the night before that he literally, in his post-game press conference, that as long as his badge was working on Monday morning, he figured he still have a job.
He's going to use it until it works.
He stayed there just in case that badge did not work, right? So, you know, Jarvis was going to be interesting to see, because I think we've all known for at least a couple weeks that he was going to likely be the first casualty.
He had the video of him allegedly smoking marijuana.
Yeah,
and
so you knew.
Howling at thoughts and stuff.
Right, right. Yeah. And you know the Redskins. Yeah. The Redskins is probably the clusterfuffles of clusterfuffles in NFL. But when you look
at it. Say the real word.
Yeah, right, exactly. Because that's really who they are. That's really who they are. But when you look at it, real talk, you've got the Jets and the Dolphins also at 0-4. And who's that casualty? Who's the next casualty?
Wow. I would say Dan Quinn, but we all know Arthur Blank is not interested in firing coaches during the middle of the season.
Fair enough. So who might be on the chopping block? Well, that remains to be seen. So, you know how I love the Florida Files. A Florida woman faces multiple charges after authorities say she climbed into the ceiling of a Big Lots store to avoid a shoplifting arrest. 37-year-old Christina Perkins went into the store's restroom and removed some tiles so she could climb into the ceiling. The news release says she ignored commands to come down. Instead, she moved to other sections of the ceiling, and a deputy stayed behind, unbeknownst to her, when the search was called off, saw her climbing out of the ceiling, and boom, arrested her on charges of criminal mischief, petty theft, and resisting law enforcement. Only in Florida. Only in Florida.
Oh, man. I mean, what is there to say at this point? I mean, it's so much craziness going on down there. What, is it something in the water? Is
it
a drug that we don't know about?
Yeah, having lived there 3 times, it's the water.
It got to be something. That's ridiculous. Well, Tyler Perry Studios. You know her, Tyler Perry, right?
Yes, sir.
Pretty famous
guy.
From
my hometown, the
N.O. He opened up on old Fort McPherson, which is a huge plot of land, by the way.
Oh, massive.
And it was a star-studded event.
Yes.
T.I. was talking about how everybody and their mama was there, so it was a lot of things going on, man. Talk about how this could be something that can be really beneficial to Tyler Perry, not only Tyler Perry, but just the African American community as a whole.
Yeah, because he made a great statement when he received his BET award a couple months ago, and he said he purposely went after that particular plot of land because from where it is, when you over the part of the city that it overlooks here in Atlanta, you can literally see some of the poorest neighborhoods in the city, and he wanted those young men, particularly those young black men, to be able to see what can be done right there, you know, within earshot of their neighborhood. So definitely shout out to him. And shout out for making something that started off with a negative past where the Confederate Army fought at Fort Mac and stayed at Fort Mac and turned it into something positive. Preseason NBA game, supposed to be fun. I know I had a great time last night seeing Zion Williamson.
It was a
dunk,
show, right?
All those it's always a show in Atlanta. People show up about 15
Indeed.
Minutes late.
Right.
It's always about, you know, see me. So, but don't tell Knicks forward Marcus Morris that it's supposed to be fun because he apparently takes things very, very seriously. Morris, who recently said he wants to bring the style of the 90s back, Charles Oakley, first seemed to hit Justin Anderson with a vicious elbow. Then he finished things off by pounding the ball into Anderson's head. And we're going to put a link to that video on our webpage on Facebook, so you guys can check it out on Twitter as well. But Morris, of course, was immediately tossed from the game. Did we really need to do the headbutt with the basketball? Yeah, like, do we really need to take it back to Pioneer of the Week, Charles Oakley?
My whole thing is with this whole trying to bring back the 90s. Like, I mean, come on. Like, do it. Don't talk about it.
Be about that.
Because you're going to bring attention to yourself. If you're trying to be that guy, if you're trying to bring that back, you need to be the person that actually take action and do it. But hit somebody upside the head with a basketball? Come on, bro.
Fake gangster.
Speaking of the Knicks Tyler Perry Studios opening, Spike Lee attended, and he bought 13 items from a Knicks memorabilia auction that included the original net from Game 7 of the 1970 NBA Finals. That is a long time ago. Next, y'all need to get better. that Lee attended, and the Coach of the Year trophy that season. Spike Lee paid $69,184 for the net and $31,000 for the trophy, man.
Yes.
Like, Spike is just relentless when it comes to this fandom, right?
But you know what? I can't be mad at him because I attended, let's see, I think it was Game 6 of the 5th championship for the Chicago Bulls, and literally have kept every single thing because I figure one day that thing's going to be worth something. All of that, my ticket stub, my newspapers, just everything. So I don't know. I think it's pretty cool, especially from a fan perspective. Like, as a fan, you always want to be able to see something.
I guess
something.
You kind of got that kind of money to blow. Right.
And,
I mean,
you know, for him, $69,000 is probably like $6.90 for the rest of us.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's
for real.
True. Yeah, I get it.
So Scouts banned, once again, it's one of those balls in the news this time. Scouts banned
from balls everywhere, huh?
All day, every day. LaMelo Ball and all them balls. Scouts banned from viewing LaMelo Ball practices because he has not declared for the draft. All you guys that I work with are like 12-year-olds, but anyway.
Yeah.
LaMelo Ball practices because he has not declared for the draft, so now Scouts are banned from checking him out? I mean, is it always something? There's always, it's always like they're forcing or trying to fake this mystique about that entire family.
I mean, you know what? I think LeVar has kind of taken a back seat to LaMelo because he saw what happened with Lonzo.
You think so?
I think he's taking a legitimate back seat because I think people are going to be able to see what LaMelo is because he shot up, what, 6-7 inches? So now he's a 6'8", you know, and he was like maybe like 6'1", 6'2", and now he's look like a legitimately going to be considered for that number one overall pick. And when you have a guy like that, there's really no need for the extra hype that he brought with Lonzo.
Yeah, absolutely. And I don't know about you, fill in the blanks fam, but I don't know if I'm buying it from LeVar quite yet, but you guys let us know what you think. Sean Merriman offers Vontaze Burfict a fight deal. Now, I got to weigh in on this for just a split second. As a diehard Steelers fan who saw that guy before he switched to switched teams, went from the Bengals to the Raiders, it's a lot going on every time he touches the field. I think on a serious note, that's one of those situations where you've got to get that kid from, you know, Pop Warner and teach that kid how to do everything. All the technique needs to be right, you know, in terms of tackling and hitting and that sort of thing. So I don't think it's always his fault. However, one time you make a mistake, twice you got my eyebrows raised. Oh, darn it, you did it about 17 times, which we talked about last week. It's you, and it's a pattern. So I don't know about him taking a fight deal from Sean Merriman to advance his career when at some point we all know he's going to try to get back into the league. How does that help his narrative at all to get back into the league? Might put a dollar in his pocket while he's suspended, but the narrative, I don't know.
I mean, if I'm Vontaze Burfict and Sean Merriman challenges me to a fight, yeah, I'm going to fight you. Yeah, let's do it. I'm down. Let's go. Because Sean Merriman got popped for steroids or HGH, however, whichever one you want to say. Because I'm like this. If a guy challenging your manhood, especially in that particular arena where it's okay to kind of defend that, by all means, go ahead, man.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, punch him in the face for me.
If
Sean Merriman has a very punchable face.
Right. If you assume that you don't ever want a career in the NFL again. So on a not so good note, you know, we thought we saw justice served in Dallas for both them Jean with Amber Geiger getting convicted for his murder. And then the key witness in that case, Joshua Brown, was shot and killed recently. And you know, Jarvis, I'm going to say this, and I know this probably sounds weird to most of our fill in the blanks fam, but When she received that conviction and we started seeing things all over the news about who the key witness was, immediately the hairs on my back and my neck stood up because I was concerned for his safety.
Yeah, because the young man did not want to testify initially. And just to see the video of his testimony, you kind of tell that the guy had an effect on him because he talked about how the young man used to, Mr. John used to sit up, he used to hear him singing gospel songs in the morning. And how that kind of had an effect on him. But when you think, actually sit down and think about somebody that wasn't really that close to you, but was close to you, because we already know how to live in an apartment complex. You get to know your neighbors and you get to get to know their routine. You know when they're there, when they're not there, a lot. So for him to know that his life was taken in that manner and the life that he lived, the type of life that he lived, because he lived, he was a Christian man, he was in church, he was a faithful guy. And for him to get his life taken like that, it's just truly, truly unfortunate. And for him trying to do a good deed to lose his life, right behind that, it's just,
that's a tough
it's very tough.
Yeah, you really, your heart goes out to the Dallas-Fort Worth community because there are more people suffering now more than ever from all three sides of that family. But, you know, we're going to go a little light and we're going to talk about somebody who inflicted a different kind of pain back in his day, our HBCU Pioneer of the Week, Charles Oakley.
All right, Charles Oakley is our HBCU Pioneer of the Week. He was born, as we all know, he was born and raised in Cleveland, Ohio.
Yes, sir.
We all know how big time, big he is in that state of in the state of Ohio. I think it's okay for him to be the second best player to come out of Ohio.
We can give him number two.
There's a guy by the name of LeBron James that's from around the way. So he attended Virginia Union University in Richmond, Virginia. Played really well. Charles Oakley just was a guy that just played the game how I guess Marcus Morris trying to emulate. But he's not necessarily doing a good job of that. So you might want to fall back on that one. But he was drafted ninth overall in 1985 in the NBA draft by his hometown team, the Cleveland Cavaliers. So he was doing some really good things, but he really made a name for himself when he moved on to the New York Knicks.
And that was probably one of my, if I can,
like, just really just imagine. Now, this may sound a little crazy, but I always marveled at how the New York Knicks, they had no, they all had all black players on that team. The entire roster was black. And that stood out to me as a young youngster. I was I was a teenager. So I was just like, wait a minute, they have all brothers on the team. So it's just some, it was just something about that, and they were just so aggressive, and they just and the team, everybody was just ready, willing to fight at a drop of a hat. Anthony Mason, Charles Smith. Well, not necessarily Charles Smith too much, but you know, John Starks. Those guys were just. It was just a persona that came with that team, and it was just so unique and genuine that it was just like you believed them. If you ran into any of those guys in an alley, they will put them hands on you, put them paws on you, as a little Scrappy would say.
Right, and you feel like when they do, it's going to be just what you thought it was going to be, and then some. And to see him, because I've seen him recently here in Atlanta, and he is still just as massive and intimidating as ever. So, Jarvis, let's get to the tee. Tiger Woods' comeback in 2019 to win the Masters, for his first major win in 11 years. He said don't call it a comeback, but, man, call it a comeback because it was his first green jacket since 2005. He's about to get a tribute from Cardi B.
Wait a minute, what?
Yeah, like,
was she going to have a red polo on and a Nike hat? And some black slacks?
She took to Insta, and she said that she would name her next album Tiger Tiger Woods, y'all. Why? Because Cardi said, because remember when everybody was talking bleep on Tiger Woods, like, oh, blah, 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 this, blah, blah, that, she said. And then he bleep came and won that green jacket. That's why I'm going to bleep, going to name my bleep, bleepity bleep album Tiger Woods.
Okay.
So she also confirmed that she will not release any new music for the rest of 2019 after releasing a couple cuts, of course, this year with Bruno Mars and Fat Joe. I Love me some Cardi B.
Cool, Cardi B.
I love our producer Corey loves it. I love me some Cardi B. I love all the ratchet, all the Bronx isms, all of that. Bring all that. I can't wait for this Tiger Woo album.
Oh, man. I mean,
I love her.
It's hard not to, you know, here's the reason why I like Cardi B. I mean, I don't really care for all the Thatchery and the Thatchery and the Ratchery and all that stuff.
It's like the polar opposite of me, so I like it. She's like my alter ego, y'all.
I like the relationship aspect of it. You know, promoting marriage and the black love. You know, I get a little sentimental when it comes to stuff like that.
I
like to see that.
Yes.
I like to see it last because it can last. It's possible.
Yeah.
It's possible.
Yes.
It's possible. It's
possible.
It can happen. You can do it. It's hard, but you can do it.
Yes.
But but that's what I love about them, you know, and see those two come together and be able to flourish in their careers, and then they can flourish together and promote that. I love that. I love that.
Right. And I think she just is one of those people who's true to self.
Right.
Like the same Cardi we saw 5-6 years ago. If you are a reality TV person, I'm not, but I've always known Corey doesn't think she's true to self, but I like the version
of
Cardi.
Let
me live and like my Cardi the way she is in my little head. So anyway, I think she is ride or die, definitely. Corey, would you at least agree to that?
Okay.
So we agree, my producer and I, the show creator agrees that she's at least ride or die, just like PJ Williams' girlfriend, okay?
Uh-oh.
So Saints Corner, PJ Williams' girlfriend tried like hell to get the NFL player out of a DUI this past January, asking a cop to have mercy on him, get this, because of the missed pass interference call in the Saints-Rams championship game. Now look, that's my people, okay?
And
I feel hurt for
them.
You know, that's my hometown. And you know, I feel for PJ and everything.
Man, you would not discuss the Saints on this show.
Oh yes, we will.
No, we're not. We will not do that. We will not.
Do you want
y'all
me
living,
to get up
living
and
the past.
Show what I get? You want this ninth ward to come out? You want
stop
this ninth ward to come
in
out?
The past,
oh,
man,
but rings, but rings and things, rings and things. So the cops tell PJ he was driving recklessly and slaps the cuffs on him after he fails a sobriety test. That's when the officer turns to the girlfriend and she goes, Mr. Officer, is there any way that you can, like, I mean, but he's a Saints player. I mean, don't you feel bad? Like, didn't you see that game? He was like, ma'am, that doesn't concern me. Doesn't concern me. Not concerned, unbothered. So PJ fought this case for nearly a year, finally cut a deal in August, amazingly, right before the season starts, right? Finally cuts a deal with prosecutors, pled guilty to a reduced charge of reckless operation of a vehicle. But I like the ride or die. I'm not mad at her for her ride or die.
He got the DUI off his record.
Yes.
Yeah.
And he's now able to focus on the Saints being able to be at the top of the NFC South in the absence of their starting QB as they make an attempt at a run back to the Super Bowl.
Are you really? Man, look, man. Come on now.
You know, I just try to keep it fair and balanced,
you
know, because, I mean, we shout out the Panthers, you know, shout out to Cam Newton and what they're doing in his absence and keeping things together.
We ain't shouting out no Saints.
Is that a bet?
You know where we shoot this show from?
Oh, the hateration.
Do you know where we shoot this show from?
Oh, but do you know where the co-host originated from?
Oh, Lord.
All right, because, you know, we got to have representation.
It ain't where you're from, it's where you're at.
Yeah, where I'm going,
you know,
back
song,
to 5 weeks is homecoming season. All right, time for us to wrap up this week's edition. We have had a blast going back and forth. You know, Jarvis and I love to go Atlanta to the NO, the NO to New Orleans, right?
You know,
if you really want to go for blows with that, I mean, we could go for blows. Like,
I don't want to.
Because you don't
want
that
smoke. I
mean,
I know what you're going to say.
I don't want that smoke right now.
You know, we can't dedicate too much time to this show talking about PJ Williams. You know, and how he should get some leniency from the police officer because he got mushed out the way. And, you know,
I love how you said that. But Jarvis, but let me give Jarvis a world of credit because, like he said, there is a whole nation of New Orleanians in Atlanta.
Right.
So let's just
go home.
Including me.
Go home.
Right.
If you don't like it, go home.
Right. So let's just
room.
Be real
go
about
home.
This thing. Right. Yeah. Exactly. So let's just be real about it. And
have some respect.
Real talk. And we didn't even get to talk about our beloved Braves today. But ultimately speaking, the Braves have been my team from way back when. So we found ways in the NO to adopt all things Atlanta.
Yeah,
we got love. We're working it out.
Yeah, we're working it out.
Yeah. And just for all you Braves fans out there, we still think positively that we will see you in
Hopefully.
The NLCS. So make sure you follow us on Instagram, on Twitter, on Facebook at Fill in the Blanks. But you know what? I think you need to give Jarvis a follow too at
Jarvis D 90. Check me out, man.
Yeah, and I think you need to give your girl a follow at Tanitra Batiste. We appreciate you, fam, for coming back and checking us out at Fill in the Blanks. We will see you next week after your girl comes back from her LA trip and after your boy takes his trip
to. We're going to the country.
Huntsville, Alabama. Peace.
Peace out.